I don't think I want any of that turkey and stuffing. Okay, our offertory hymn, In the Garden, page 297. We'll sing verses 1 and 3. Spending a little time with Jesus. It's nice to have him in our lives. Let's stand and sing. No one can ever know what that feels unless they experience it too.
Lord, we come to you this morning, thank you for everything that you bestow upon us, especially this time of year. And now we want to return to you a small portion of the blessings that you bestow upon us, for you to use as your name and prayer. Amen.
Choir's going to be singing a song this morning. It speaks for itself. Jesus is coming soon.
Yeah.
hands with your neighbor while they're coming down.
Thinking about Thanksgiving reminded me of this song. We've sang it before. I've sang it before. The choir sang it before. So I know that a lot of you know it. So one thing that I'm thankful for, probably more than anything else, is that when Jesus was on the cross, I was on his mind. So let's sing this together. If you know it, sing with me. If you don't know the verses, sing the chorus. Let's just praise the Lord this morning that we have a home to go to beyond here. Mistakes, I often slip, just common flesh and bones, but I prove someday just what I say. I'm of a special yet
You know, as Becky was singing that song, just can't help to think of how unworthy I am to stand and preach the gospel. I'm thankful we have a Savior that loves us today. Praise God. If you'll turn in your Bibles to Acts chapter 22 for me today. Acts chapter 22. We're talking about having a thankful heart. Paul was in a situation in the book of Acts to where we are that he was seized in the temple by the Jews. He was bound in chains by the Jewish people. But yet he was still preaching the gospel. He was still sharing his testimony. You know, it's easy to be a Christian during the good times. It's easy to be a Christian when you're sitting in a church surrounded by believers, hearing music that we've heard this morning and lifting our hands in praise. I feel like those are the easy times when it's easy to be a Christian. But as you probably know today, not all days are like that. Sometimes you feel seized. Sometimes you feel like you're in chains. Sometimes you feel like you're struggling. But God's still there. But God's still there. I want you to flip to Acts 22. We're starting verse 6 and go to verse 16. If you have your place, stand with me this morning as we honor the reading of God's word. He says in verse 6, "And it came to pass that as I made my journey and was come nigh unto Damascus, about noon, suddenly there shone from heaven a great light round about me, and I fell unto the ground and heard a voice saying unto me, Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me? And I answered, Who art thou, Lord? And he said unto me, I am Jesus of Nazareth, whom thou persecutest. And they that were with me saw indeed the light and were afraid, but they heard not the voice of him that spake to me. And I said, What shall I do, Lord? And the Lord said unto me, Arise, go to Damascus, and there it shall be told of thee all things which are appointed for thee to do. And when I could not see for the glory of that light, being led by the hand of them that were with me, I came into Damascus. And one Ananias, a devout man, according to the law, having a good report of all the Jews which dwelt there, came unto me and stood and said unto me, Brother Saul, receive thy sight. And the same hour I looked up upon him. And he said, The God of our fathers hath chosen thee, that thou shouldest know his will, and see that just one, and shouldest hear the voice of his mouth. For thou shalt be his witness unto all men of what thou hast seen and heard. And now, why tarriest thou? Arise and be baptized, and wash away thy sins, calling on the name of the Lord. Father, we thank you, Jesus, for today. God, we thank you, Lord, that our home is set aside, Father, for those who have called upon your name. God, I'm thankful, Lord, for this season, God, of a thankful, just a thankful time that we can look back at all the blessings that you have given us. Lord, in your name we pray. Amen. Amen. You may be seated this morning. So I want to look at several things today, talking about a thankful heart. And I pray today that you have a thankful heart. I was reminded several years ago that not everybody has good holiday seasons. People that have lost loved ones during this time of the year, or maybe this is the first time you've spent a holiday without a loved one, this is going to be tough for you. But I can assure you today that if you are a believer of Jesus Christ, this will not be a season that you will go through alone. That Jesus will be there every day, every step, minute by minute, day by day. But we can be thankful today, regardless what season we're in. If we are a Christian, we can be thankful knowing that we serve a risen Savior today. So I want to look at five things this morning, and the first one is being the credentials. I want you to look in verse 3, chapter 22, verse 3. I want to look at his credentials. Look at what he says. He says, I am verily a man which am a Jew, born in Tarsus, a city of Cilicia. He says, yet brought up in this city, that the feet of Gamaliel, and taught according to the perfect manner of the law of the fathers, and was zealous toward God, as ye all were this day. He says, and I persecuted this way unto death, binding and delivering into prisons both men and women, as also the high priest doeth bear me witness in all the estate of elders, from whom also I received letters unto the brethren, and went to Damascus to bring them which were bound unto Jerusalem for to be punished. You see, Paul was giving his credentials, but his credentials meant nothing in a relationship with Jesus. This morning, you may have credentials that outside the church, people would think, man, you got it together. You're a believer. You may get say, well, you know what? I've been going to church my whole life. I've been going to church since before I was born. My mom took me to church every day before I was born and every day since. Those are my credentials. Church, this morning you can go to church your entire life and still die and go to hell. Those are not credentials. Those are man-made things that you think is above the blood of Jesus Christ. Paul was saying in verse 1, he says, I am a Jew. I was born into the bloodline, into the lineage of Abraham, so therefore that makes me saved. No, it doesn't. If you were born and your family or leaders in the church, well, praise God, I'm thankful for it, but that doesn't make you a believer today. Who you were born into, the family you were born into. Well, my family gives the most. Well, praise God for that. Thank you for your contribution into the kingdom of heaven. That does not make you a believer of Jesus Christ. That makes that you're doing what God has called you to do, not that you're going into heaven. You see, so he says, I'm a Jew. I was born in Tarsus. I was taught by the greatest high priest. Gamaliel was one of the greatest high priests of that time, and Paul said, I was taught by him. I know the most. There's only one person that knows the most, and his name's Jesus. Every day we learn more things about our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. When you read your Bible, you are enlightened day after day after day of how good God really is. We will never get to the point to where we know enough. We're always growing in our faith toward the Lord. Look what he says in the end of verse 3. He says, he was taught according to the perfect manner of the law of the fathers. You see, there's this problem. You're talking about the law of the fathers. You see, that's a lowercase f. That's not a capital F. He's not talking about the father. He's talking about men. He said, I've learned the law of the men. If you're following anything but the law of the Lord, you're putting your faith and trust in something that does not matter. You see, Jesus is the law. He says, and I was zealous toward God as you all were this day. They're zealous. They are ready to follow the laws of the Jews to the very end. But at this point, Jesus has already died on the cross. He had already resurrected into heaven. It wasn't the law that they needed to be worried about. It was Jesus. It was surrendering their heart and life to him. This morning, the first point that I'm talking about is credentials, and I want you to understand my heart so strongly this morning. Your credentials don't mean anything if Jesus is not the only one that's there. He is your credential. He is the one that has called you to accept him as your Lord and Savior this morning. It's not your credentials. It's not where you're born. It's not what you know. It's that you've given your life to Jesus. The first thing I wanted to look at this morning was Paul's credentials. But you know, God gets a hold of us sometimes when we think we're a little better than we really are. Have y'all ever been humbled in your life before? you thought you knew all things, and then somebody come along and showed you real quick that you weren't nearly as wise as you thought you were. So the first thing I want to look at is her credentials. The second thing is the capture. Look what he says in verse 6 and 7. It's so amazing. It's so ironic that Paul had spent, or Saul at the time, had spent so much of his life. And even he says in this passage in verse 4, he says, I persecuted this way unto the death and the binding and the delivering unto the prisons, both men and women. He had spent so much time persecuting believers, capturing these believers. The end of verse 5 says, and to bring them unto which they were bound unto Jerusalem for to be punished. But look what happens in verse 6 and 7. He's recalling. This is his testimony. In verse 6 it says, and it came to pass that as I made my journey, I want to stop right there, in his capture, look what he says, as I made my journey. Isn't it great when you finally get to that point where you realize your life is not your life? Your journey is not your journey. You see, when you accept Jesus as your Savior, you quickly realize you've been going down the wrong road your whole life. It may look like a good road. It may be a profitable road. But if it ain't a road, that's terrible English. If it's not a road that leads to Jesus, it's the wrong road. Paul was saying, I was heading down my journey. I was heading my way. If you're here this morning and you've never accepted Christ, I'm praying today is the day that you realize that the journey that you're on, a journey without Jesus is the wrong journey. The journey without Jesus is the wrong journey. He says, it came to pass that as I made my journey and was come nigh to Damascus about noon. How many of y'all thought that the Damascus Road experience with Paul happened at night? Any of y'all think that? It's okay if you want to be, it's okay that you don't know. It's interesting that this was not a night experience. We all think it was. Most people think it was because there was a bright light that was shining. So we just assume that it was a nighttime experience and this spotlight type of moment come down where Paul was or where Saul was and all of his men. But no, it was the middle of the day. The sun was the highest point of the day. And the Bible says that suddenly there shone around heaven a great light round about him. We saw the credentials. The capture is this. No matter how bright your day or your life you think it is, it can always get brighter when Jesus comes into your life. You may think, man, I got it. I've got it mapped out. Everything's good. All things are great. My job's great. My family's great. We're healthy. I got some vacation lined up. We're going to have a good Christmas. All these, the Thanksgiving's lined up. If everything is happening and Jesus is not the center point of all of those things, you're still in the dark. You have no clue what's around you. In the brightest part of your day, Jesus is always brighter. He's always, what some of these old timers say, he's always gooder no matter what you got going on, right? He's always gooder. So he says, it was about noon. Suddenly there shone around from heaven a great light round about me. He says, and I fell unto the ground. Isn't that interesting? Go back to verse 4. And I persecuted this way unto death, binding and delivering into the prisons both men and women. Don't you think Saul was sitting here looking like that he was being bound? He was being persecuted? The Bible says he was struck down by bright light. The Bible says that he couldn't see. He had no way to go here or there because he didn't know which way to go. You see, Saul was thinking he was the one doing the persecuting, and God showed him real quick, you think you're persecuting me, look what I can do to you. You see, you think that you're making problems. You don't want to go toe-to-toe with God. You don't want to threaten our Lord. You don't want to persecute believers. You say, Michael, I'm not persecuting believers. Matthew chapter 12, verse 30 says, if you aren't for me, you are against me. If you're not a believer this morning that is lifting up the precious name of Jesus, if you're not encouraging those that are around you, you are persecuting believers. If you are living a life and on Sundays and Wednesdays that you are just glowing with the Christian language and the Christian way, but on Monday to Friday, you're living like Christ on Sunday, but you're living like Jezebel the rest of the week, you're persecuting the church. because you're pushing people away from the gospel of Jesus Christ. Persecution doesn't just happen with sticks and whips and chains and different things that Paul was using. Persecution happens if you're hurting the church in any way. You see, that's persecution. The Bible says he was being captured in verse 6 and verse 7. He says, I fell to the ground. So we've seen the credentials in verses 3 through 5. We see the capture in verses 6 through the beginning of 7. We see the conviction in verses the beginning of 7 to the end of 8. He says, I fell into the ground, and I heard a voice saying unto me, Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me? See, some of y'all here this morning, you've heard that. You've heard that voice week after week after week. You know what that conviction feels like because you felt it over and over and over again. And you say, as he says in verse 8, who art thou? He says, who are you? You see, I wrote down some names that I found of who Jesus is called in the Bible. Who is he? Who is Jesus? Well, the Bible calls him Emmanuel, which means God with us. The Bible calls him the Lamb of God, Alpha and Omega, King of Kings, King of Jews, Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace, the Bread of Life, the Redeemer, the Living Stone, the Light of the World, the Good Shepherd, the True Vine, the Rock, the Savior, the Messiah. You see, Jesus is the Messiah. He is the Son of God. Who is Jesus to you today? Is he a safety net? Or is he someone you call on when you get sick or you're hurting? Is he someone you blame when things are going bad? Or is he your Savior? You see, that word Savior means something a little different. That means he died for you and you accepted that he died for you. That you accepted all of the work that he done for you. You see, there was a conviction that fell upon Saul's heart because he says, who art thou, Lord? And he said unto me, I am Jesus Christ, whom thou persecutest. You remember what it was like when you were convicted? Those of you in the room this morning that have been saved and you've accepted the Lord, you remember what it's like when you were convicted by Jesus? Man, that Holy Spirit was tugging on your heart. That's a feeling that you've never felt before, right? And then you asked Jesus to come into your life, and man, all of that weight just released off of your life, off of your heart. Because he says, come and take upon my yoke because it's light and it's easy. He said, lay your burdens down at my feet. You see, that's what you do when you accept Christ as your Savior. You see, Paul was being convicted in verse 7 and verse 8. He says, I am Jesus. And maybe somebody in this room this morning, that's a conversation you're having with the Lord right now. And he's telling you, I am Jesus. I am your Savior. But you have to accept me. You see, I want to show you this. Look in verse 9. He says, and they that were with me saw indeed the light and were afraid, but they heard not the voice of him that spake to me. You see, they didn't get the whole thing. They didn't get the whole experience. All they saw was the bright light from heaven. You see, there's a passage in the book of Daniel. It's Daniel chapter 10, verse 7. I want to read this to you. Daniel 10, verse 7. If I can flip there real quick. Can you get it on the screen real quick? That'll be faster. You got it, Easton? Look at you, big guy. Easton's doing great filling in this morning. Daniel chapter 10, verse 7. Here we go. And I, Daniel, alone, saw the vision. For the men that were with me saw not the vision, but a great quaking fell upon them, so that they fled to hide themselves. You see, that's the same thing that happened to Daniel happened to Saul. They only felt half of the experience of God. You see, before you accept Christ, you can come to church. You can get the emotion. You can hear a song that was sang and it gives you goosebumps or it touches your heart and tears come to your eyes. But a relationship with Christ is not an emotional roller coaster. It is a personal, intimate relationship with the Savior. It happens and it holds you more than just from 11 to 12. It's for the rest of your life. You're filled with the joy that no one can take away from you. You see, for Saul, the men that were here in verse 9, there was this feeling that they saw the light, but they didn't hear anything. I don't want you to just hear the message this morning. I'm begging you to accept Jesus. There's a difference between hearing a message and accepting Jesus as your Savior. There's a difference. So they got half of what it was meant to be. And then in verses 10 and 11, there was a clarification. So we've seen the credentials, we've seen the capturing, we've seen the conviction. But here's the clarification in verses 10 and 11. And he said, "What shall I do?" And that's a question that a lot of people ask. What do I do now? I feel like God moving in my heart. I feel like maybe I need to be saved, but what do I do? Well, the Bible says if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, he is faithful and just to forgive you. You see, Paul is asking, at this time, Saul was asking in verse 10, he says, "Lord, what shall I do?" And the Lord said unto me, isn't that great? Isn't that great when we ask God a question, he hears us? We don't serve a tomb with a bunch of bones in it. We don't serve a grave this morning. We're not going to a cemetery and bowing down before a tombstone saying, "God, I hope I hear you. I hope you hear me." The Word of God says that Jesus resurrected from the tomb and he ascended into heaven, and right now he's seated at the right hand of the Father. And when his Father gives him the time, gives him the look, gives him the nod, he's coming back to get us. He's coming back to get his church. So when Saul says, "What do I do?" the Lord said unto him, he said unto me, "Arise." If you're here this morning, you say, "Michael, what do I do? I want to be saved. What do I do?" Can I tell you this? Word of God says in the book of Acts, it's the same applying effect today. You need to arise. You need to get up out of the life that you're in. You need to let go of the things that is hindering you, that is burdening you, and you need to let go of all of that. You need to arise from where you are and say, "Lord, I am your child, and I accept you as my Savior." He told him, "Arise and go to Damascus, and there it shall be told thee the things which are appointed for thee." Listen to that, the end of verse 10. He said, the things that will be appointed for thee to do. He had a job already lined up. God was just waiting on him to accept the position. He was just waiting on him to say, "Lord, I trust in you, God. Lord, I'm ready to surrender." There are things that God has lined up in store for you in your life. He's just waiting on you to say, "God, how can I do it? God, what can I do? Show me how I can be a believer. Show me how I can help in the kingdom of God. Express to me, show me, Lord Jesus, what you want me to do." He says, "There are things which are appointed for thee to do." That's just for Saul. Do you believe this morning that God has something in store? He has a job. He has a plan for you that nobody else but you can do. Nobody else but you. You say, "Well, Michael, there's people all around that are more qualified than you." So? Who cares? You know, back in 2012 when I felt God calling Stacy and I and Lane out of being a youth pastor role here, from being into a pastor role, I started going to association offices because I didn't know what else to do, and I started giving them my resume, which looked about as great as this piece of notebook paper, this index card right here. Wasn't real pretty, right? So I handed it to the guy. It was not very impressive. The guy looked at me and he said, "You'll never pastor anywhere around here." And I said, "Well, why?" He said, "You're not qualified." He said, "There's more people that are more qualified than you. You'll never pastor around here." And I said, "Well, praise the Lord. Thank you." You know, it wasn't about 6 months later that I was called to be the pastor at Cherokee Springs Baptist Church, first church I ever pastored. You know, in my flesh, I wanted to send him a card with the church name on it and say, thank you for all your help. You see, there's going to be people in your life that's going to tell you you aren't qualified. But God has a job for you that's just for you. Nobody else can do it. There's somebody today that's counting on you to give them the gospel. And only you can do it in a way that they can understand it. You are qualified by Jesus Christ. If you have been saved this morning, you are qualified through the calling of the Lord. He tells them that there are things appointed for thee to do. Verse 11, still clarifying, and he says, and one Ananias, a devout man, according to the law, having a good report of all the Jews which dwelt there. I want to stop right here in the clarification, and I want to say this. This morning, you may think, well, if I'm a believer, none of this stuff applies to me. Right here applies to you. Right here. You know, I talked before we even got started this morning. You know, it's easy to be a believer when it's easy. Do you think Ananias really wanted to go before Paul, before Saul? He had the reputation of murdering Christians. And God says, Ananias, I need you to go to Saul and heal him. I need you to go to him and tell him about me. He was putting himself right in front of the biggest persecutor of the church. Do you think Ananias said, you got the wrong guy? I don't want to do it. I've got a family. Kind of reminds me of Moses in the book of Exodus. Send somebody else. But he was the one to go and talk to Saul. He was the one. The Bible says that he was devout. That's what it says. He was a devout man according to the law, having a good report of all the Jews which dwelt there. He had a good report among the Jews, and Saul was a Jewish person. He was a Jew. So there was a clarification. Let me tell you something. If you've got somebody in your life right now, Christians, folks in here that have accepted Jesus, if you've got somebody in your life right now and you're choosing not to talk to them about Jesus, about something that they've done to you, shame on you. That is not a believer. That is not the acts of a believer. You say, well, Michael, you don't get it. Well, let me tell you what I get. Let me tell you what I get. I get that Jesus has died for us, and I get that Jesus has forgiven us over and over and over again. I get every day his grace is new and fresh. Every day his love is sufficient to last of all eternity. The number of times that Jesus has looked upon you when you are crying out to God and saying, Lord, forgive me, I was wrong, I shouldn't have done this or that, and God never says, you know what, no. I'm not going to do that. Has he ever told you that? Not based on my Bible, he hasn't. So what gives us the authority to do that? You see, we're just like the moon. We have no light of our own. The only light that comes out of the moon is what's reflected from the sun. You see, we're just reflecting the light of Christ. We don't have our own light. You see, there was a clarification that had to be given. Last thing this morning is this. It's the Christian confirmation, starting in verse 12. He told him that he was a devout believer according to the law. Verse 13, he says, and he came to me and he stood and he said to me, Brother Saul, receive thy sight. In the same hour I looked upon him. How amazing is it that this journey, the people that were around Saul had to walk him from the Damascus road all the way to the chair sitting in front of Ananias. They had to walk him. You know what I've learned in the short amount of life that I have lived? Sometimes you need to take it a little slower. Sometimes you need to let God speak to you a little more. I've learned that sometimes you don't always have to go 100 miles an hour. Sometimes it's good just to say, God, I need to talk. I need to have that conversation. You see, Saul had to be slowed down, and he had to be spoken to in a way to where he couldn't see, so he had no choice but to listen. Verse 14, and he said, the God of our fathers have chosen thee, that thou shouldest know his will and see the just one and should hear the voice of his mouth. He says, and thou shalt be a witness unto all men of what thou hast seen and heard. That passage is just as true today as it was when Ananias told Saul, God has chosen you. He said, why would God choose me? Well, the Bible says in John 3:16, for God so loved the world. That means you. You're a part of the world. I've heard people tell me before that God will never forgive me of the things that I've done. Saul was a murderer of Christians, and he forgave him. The people in this room, I guarantee you, before they were saved, they were not perfect, and they're not now. He says, here is a job for you. You see, God has a job for you this morning. The last thing I want to look at is this in verse 16. The Christian confirmation. Verse 16 says this, and now why tarriest thou? You know what he's saying? What are you waiting on? What are you waiting on? He says, arise, be baptized, wash away thy sins, calling on the name of the Lord. I ask you the same question this morning. What are you waiting on? You've heard the gospel preached. What are you waiting on? So I was talking to a friend of mine. And I want y'all hear me. Don't be packing up. We can do that in a minute. You know, I was talking to a friend of mine about the prodigal son story this past week. We were actually eating Mexican food, believe it or not. I know that's shocking. But we were sitting there eating some cheese dip, talking about Jesus, greatest thing in the world. We were talking about the prodigal son. And we were talking about when the prodigal son had wasted everything that his father had given him, and he was sitting in the pig's mud, and he rehearsed what he was going to tell his father when he got back home. And he said, okay, he said, I'm going to arise. So the Bible said he stood up out of the mess that he was in, and he went back to his father. The Bible says in that passage that the father was watching. He was waiting on him. Now, we don't know how long the son had been gone. It doesn't really tell us in the scripture, but it says he had been gone. He had been gone into another place, and he had wasted everything, all of his inheritance. His father was watching for him. The Bible said his father was watching for him, and he saw him, that he ran to him. The father did. The king. He ran to him, and he put his arms around him, and he hugged him, and he kissed him. You're like, man, what a great father. See, what a lot of people don't understand in that passage is the principle behind that, the law behind that. If a person leaves the village and takes an inheritance like that, if he comes back, they kill him because of what he's done. Because he has said to his family, I don't need you anymore. I'm going to take what's mine now and I'm leaving. So if he comes back, he dies. You see, that father didn't just love him in the way that we love our family. He saved his life. Because if he hugged him, they wouldn't kill him. You see, this morning, Jesus has done more for you than you could ever imagine. There's nothing that we can do to match what Jesus has done for us. But you can accept him as your Savior. So I ask you again today, what are you waiting on? Today may be the very last chance you have to trust him as your Savior. And if you don't do it today, I'm not saying that something's going to happen to you. I pray it doesn't. But we don't know. And today may be the last opportunity you have to trust in Christ. What are you waiting on? If you would stand with me this morning. If Miss Janet, if you would come up and play a song for us.